where Spider-Man is suing the Daily Bugle for libel.
Awesome.
That is an awesome story. Are we recording?
Yes, now we are.
Awesome.
So they caught the whole thing about you liking She-Hulk.
Hey, you know, I'm not ashamed.
Greetings.
Hi.
Hello, everyone.
Who are you?
They're the audience.
Oh.
Ah. It's actually a microphone you're staring at right now, but there are people listening.
Well, I mean, not right now, because we're recording it.
Yeah.
Someone will be listening to this at some point. Just
yes.
Not right now. Anyways.
Okay, so,
oh, paying attention. Okay,
the door is... Is everybody in?
Yeah.
Getting
no.
Loading.
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 Still loading.
Okay.
Okay.
Everything's popping up. Here we go. I'm here.
Okay, and the door is ripped open by a troglodyte who's able to just rip it off its hinges.
Whoa.
Oh, yeah. That. The giant troglodyte.
Oh, man.
That I'm currently standing in front of.
Yep.
Uh-oh.
So, roll initiative.
Yep. Probably a good idea. I'm still raging, so my initiative has dropped down to a 1. So, 9! Sometimes I hate myself for not having improved initiative.
That's 18 it. Plus dex, right?
Yeah.
21.
Alright.
We're just jumping right in, aren't we? Awesome.
We are.
Well, we did leave off with the door being ripped off its hinges, so yeah.
Cool.
What was the total?
15. Kill these off, aren't I? I'm going to kill them with cheese.
Go ahead.
I remember watching a Wallace and Gromit cartoon where he goes to the moon because he thinks it's made of cheese. Because he wants cheese for his crackers.
Yeah, I know that one.
And this cracker's falling apart.
Oh no!
Eat it, put it in your mouth. That's what she said. Sorry.
Yeah.
Or he said. The case may be.
What's your dex mod?
My dex mod? Well, actually, I'm not particularly. It's a 2.
Okay.
Oh, god damn it. All of these have been split in half.
Yeah, they're pretty crumbly.
First up is Keone.
Oh, me.
Yep.
I sing things, don't I? That's what I do. I perform. Am I able to do that? Can I move?
You would need to move, but it's not a place.
Okay.
Yeah.
Like there?
Yep.
And...
You'll be unable to start the...
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
So...
First round of combat.
I ready my guitar.
Alright. Atala.
I'm gonna swallow that on my fucking wall.
Swallow, man! Swallow!
I have reach into this square in front of Theoden.
Yes.
I'm calling him Theoden because that's what his character, that's what the token's name was in the other game. And I
no, you wouldn't have reach into that square.
Would I have to move? Could I? I'd have to move up to get reach, wouldn't I?
Yes.
Hmm.
Well.
And it's sig 3 this time.
Let's see. 1, 2, 3, and I'm gonna ready an attack, so that as soon as he gets within range,
that would
I won't be able to ready an attack. Damn.
Because apparently, in actual rules, first round of combat, you're able to either move or perform a standard action.
Yep.
Okay. So apparently, first round of combat is the perfect way to space everyone out and ready to do actual shit.
Alright, so I move there. That's my action.
Okay. Siegfried.
I, instead of moving, am going to ready an action. As soon as he comes out, I'll attack him.
Okay.
So I'll just stay perfectly still. So I got 14.
Does not hit.
Okay.
And swings his club.
It's a bit of that.
And 20. Does a 14 hit?
No.
Okay. He does 3 damage.
An attack roll?
Let's see. That would be... How are you tripping it? She has a whip. That's right.
Yep.
Would be good.
Yes.
And because it has reach, I can stay out of its attack of opportunity range.
That is correct. Oops.
Yep.
Oh man, I found a perfect...
Yeah. Let's go ahead and roll. I don't know what he's looking for.
Yeah. Go ahead.
Oh, he's going to charge his iPhone.
7.
I needed.
7 all together or 7 on the
top? 7 all together.
7 will do it.
No. Did I fail by 10 or more?
That's what I'm checking now.
Okay. Man, I found the perfect song. For your character to sing in order to inspire me.
Oh god.
It's the Skyrim parody.
The Skyrim parody? What happens if you fail by 10 or more?
I fall instead.
Using your own whip?
Yep.
What? How does failing a trip using a whip?
Don't speak. Just roll it.
Okay.
Roll of it! Ah! We're playing a game where we roll the daddy!
Yeah!
For the same reason Indiana Jones has a scar on his cheek.
True.
That's more like not being proficient with the weapon you're using, though.
Still, a
evidently,
whip would...
whips are harder to mess with, I guess. It's more than just pointy end goes in the bad guy.
Sticks and stones may break my bones, but chains and whips excite me. That was an actual Rihanna song.
I know.
Really?
Yes.
Yeah.
Not just like as a parody of the common thing. It was
nope.
It's an actual song. Yet Tiffany showed it to me once.
You have to send this to me. Because the
what is.
Rihanna was also a victim of abuse.
Well,
so,
yeah.
I mean...
It does not fail by 10 or more.
So you're perfectly
okay.
Fine.
I stay up.
So you just whip the air.
Atomic.
I'm gonna poke him with the pointy end of my spear.
Alright.
as if there's any other end to poke him with.
Poteen goes into the other man. We have a lot of work to do.
I didn't know if there was any bonuses ongoing from the last time, so. Confuddled. 18 hits. So that's 1d8 plus 2. 4 plus 2, 6. Please tell me he does not have damage reduction.
Oh, I'm attacking again.
We get hero points.
Seriously? No, there's no way that's going to hit.
Yeah.
Apparently I'm raging so hard that I can't see straight.
You know, that's my excuse, too.
I got a 2 on the die, so...
Okay.
He didn't like getting poked, so he's going to step over here.
Does that provoke an attack, or
it does not? It's not, step.
Damn.
And... let's see.
Would it provoke an attack? Oh, that's right, it would provoke an attack, because it's a 5-foot... God damn it!
I mean, you're doing the thing I do. You're doing the thing I do where you forget what you just asked.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, my excuse is that I'm stupid.
He swings his club and misses and snaps at you but misses as well.
You said it, not me.
That's a lot of good juking.
Because she was just standing still the whole time, and he kept missing.
Okay.
Well,
he's flanked! Ooh!
Since dexterity also figures in your armor class, it's pretty much all the same maneuvering past his attacks.
I think it's funnier just to think that she's standing still and he can't hit shit.
True.
She hits him for 8 points of damage.
Cool.
Ow.
Being outdone by the cleric.
Who are you telling?
It is Keone.
Play that beautiful bean footage.
Let's see.
What am I encouraging you guys to do? That's a good piece.
Brace the Robin ride away.
We'll save the rest for next round.
Gotcha. Yes. Yes.
I want it to be known that Siegfried is looking at Keone like, the fuck.
And Keone is a girl, so... Huh.
Thank you for that beautiful inspiration, I guess.
Remember, your girlfriend's breasts.
Okay.
It's what you're fighting for.
Alright, so, everybody gets a plus one.
Oh, I think the GM has had enough.
Oh!
Now you know how I feel.
To put my drink down. Oh, boy.
Okay, well... Tal is going to 5-foot step and take an attack. Why am I looking at that?
That's a 20.
Roll to confirm, since this is rolls.
Okay, so it's, let's see, 8 plus, would an 11 hit?
It does not.
Alright, so it's just a regular hit.
Yes.
A manly 3.
Alright. He goes down.
Oh, sweet. What?
Woohoo!
You speared him so hard with that 3.
Oh, yeah.
Alright.
Oh, now that combat's over, we're not going to hear the rest of that until next round.
Awesome.
Don't worry. There will probably be more combat.
In one of the next two doors that are still shut.
Okay.
I was raging for 2 rounds.
Okay, so he goes down. He has 2 keys on him.
Keys?
And then just a club.
Yeah. Alright, I want it to be known right now that I have finished. I am now no longer raging, and I'm going to be fatigued for the next 6 minutes.
6 minutes?
Jesus Christ!
No. You're doing your math wrong.
Fatigue on a core barbarian is by minutes, isn't it?
No, it's by rounds.
Okay, then 6 rounds.
Okay.
Holy shit!
I'm going to be fatigued for 6.
If you did 6 rounds of rage, it'd be 12 rounds of fatigue.
Yeah. I mean, I took care of that map. I just know that I'm going to be fatigued for 6 rounds worth of time now.
Okay. So, he has on him.
I am sorry, but it is Canada Dry.
So,
he has on him 2 keys.
Wait,
why do I keep closing this thing?
I don't know.
I opened it and then switched and closed it 3 times in a row. Okay.
I'll grab the keys, since I've usually been the one opening the doors.
Kara heals everybody up. You step in the room. A brazier of glowing coals sits in the center of this room, its acrid smoke mixing with the ever-present troglodyte stench. A few knives, pokers, and other metal implements lie atop a rusty iron box nearby.
Disable device on the iron box.
I just would like to point out that the troglodyte had 2 keys on it.
Well, are there traps with that?
We would do a perception on it.
Okay, then a perception.
Okay.
I test the keys on the lockbox.
One of them opens it.
Sweet.
Alright. Inside, you find a suit of masterwork studded leather armor, a masterwork buckler, a masterwork rapier, a short bow with 15 arrows, a scroll of cure moderate wounds, a scroll of invisibility, an odd-looking compass, a climber's kit, and 2 acid flasks.
Yeah. I'll save it for later. I'm gonna have more cheese.
Super.
Masterwork studded leather armor.
Gum?
Sure. Would masterwork studded leather be better than scale mail?
I can wear studded leather, can't I? I can wear studded leather.
I'm not too worried about it, considering that we're just going to have to hand it in to the society. We'd have to buy it at the end.
Yeah, but we could use it now.
You can use it during the scenario.
I know, I'm just...
If you want to take the time to equip it.
I'm happy with what I've got. But...
Yeah, I'm okay.
Okay.
Well, you should.
I mean, I shouldn't really strip down in front of, you know, a guy. So.
You might see your tail.
Yeah.
I'm an elf.
And?
Are you a eunuch?
You know, honestly, these are two girl strangers. I don't know anything about them. They could be lesbians, and, you know, that would just be weird.
Okay.
This is fantasy. Everybody's bi.
This is a Dragon Age 2.
How do you know I'm bi?
I'm going to take the climber's kit.
Okay.
I might just be pansexual.
And I'll also take the two acid flasks.
All right.
It'd probably be a nice way to
don't drop them.
Melt a lock.
Don't drop them.
Yeah, I won't.
Drop that acid. Making jokes about things that we know so very well.
Oh, of course. Yeah.
Drop acid all the time.
You know, so, when I go to the karaoke bar.
There is, to your immediate northwest, or northeast, there's a room. And then there's also a door that you did not go through back in the other room.
Press on or backtrack?
Let's head forward.
Forward!
I test the door.
It's locked.
Take 10 for traps. That's a 16.
You can't take 10. But you can't take 10 or 20 when there's a risk associated with it.
Ooh, that's 31. There's or not 21. Yeah, 21. What did I say? Nothing wrong with it? Okay, then I use the key on it.
Alright.
Actually, traditionally, hasn't it been me who's been running forward and getting herself hurt?
Oh.
With the spiders, the spear trap, and the skeleton.
You open the door, and there's a man in the corner, and he cringes away for a moment before seeing that you are not a troglodyte. Who are you?
Huh.
Keone! Hi! Who are you?
He shifts, and you see that he's in manacles. I'm Balinor. Please help. Are you here to help me out?
Yeah, sure. She starts picking the locks on the manacles.
One second. How did you come to be in here?
I just got in over my head. I thought I could... I'm a member of an organization that looks highly on people who are capable of finding new things, and I thought I could handle this, and I found out very quickly that I was incorrect.
Would it happen to be associated in any way with a museum?
No.
Because last time when we were asking the guy at the bar, he said, of course I work for a museum.
Well, does it mean that they're connected? He could be from a different thing.
How long have you been trapped here?
Not long. Maybe 3 days. They keep me in this room. I'm not sure how long the time has passed.
Go ahead and release them.
Like I need your permission?
There was a chance that he posed a risk.
He's in manacles. Come on. Obviously a prisoner. Come on. She undoes.
He rubs his wrist and says, did you happen to find my things?
What things?
Oh, let's see. Suit of masterwork. Leather armor, masterwork rapier, masterwork buckler.
You mean all that stuff you're wearing?
All I took was the climber's kit and the flasks. Yeah, most of your stuff is in the lockbox back there, but And he holds up the flasks. I think these are yours, too.
You can keep them. Thank you. Thank you awesome. So much.
Yep. Awesome.
Cool.
Alright.
So is the way clear to leave?
Down, yes. I wouldn't go through the other door yet.
Isn't there... Didn't we leave, like, a shambling corpse or something?
Yeah. Stay away from the second floor.
Just that whole floor. Don't go near it.
I'm sure by now he's scratching at the door.
Alright. Thank you so much.
Oh, and there are dogs outside. You might want to feed them if they mess with you.
Yep.
Tonight, there's a lodge. He pulls out, after going through his stuff, he pulls out a map of Absalom and shows you a particular area and says, meet me here tonight. I'll cover any room or board you need for the evening as repayment. Thank you so much. And then he leaves.
Sweet! Kindness does pay.
Exactly.
Alright.
So. Head ball. Snapping.
Is there anything else to this room, or is it just,
Nope.
Alright. Other door?
Yep.
Alright. If anyone is going to fall on the... If anyone's going to fall on the knife, it's gonna be me.
Are you gonna at least, like, look at the door to see if it's trapped?
Ladies first.
She's gonna open the door.
Without looking at it to see if there's a trap. Please tell me there's a trap.
There's no trap.
Oh, you got lucky. But there might be people on the other side.
Nope.
Oh, there's a frog, though.
You open the door and are immediately jumped by a frog.
Is it a big frog?
It is a giant frog. Does a 16 hit you?
It meets my AC.
Okay. Does 8 points of damage, and you're grappled.
Alright.
Oh, awesome.
It bites you.
The Hypnotoad!
Are we still in the old turn order?
Yes.
Oh, it just popped up.
Nice.
So,
maybe they finally fixed that.
Maybe. We'll just keep it how it is. So, Natala, you may attempt to break the grapple if you would like.
Would that provoke an attack of opportunity?
No.
Okay. What do I need to beat?
Whatever the CMB is.
Yeah. It does. You have broken the grapple. But that's all you can do.
Wah, wah.
So, Siegfried's turn.
Would I be able to 5 foot step and do my touch of destiny, or...
Yes.
Okay. 5 foot step... And touch a destiny on Atala. So, for your next round, you get a plus one to everything but damage roll.
Hey, for me to attack a frog, would I have to be where Keone is, or would I have reach into that square?
You do not have reach into that square.
Okay. So, Keone, you'll probably have to move.
Okay.
Alright. I'll use that at least twice, I think.
Alright, but so it's the cleric's turn.
She's going to 5 foot step. To heal you for 4 damage.
Alright.
Next up.
It's Keone. 5 foot step and get out a ration.
Okay.
And throw it at the frog.
It's not impressed.
Ooh. Frog is not amused.
Let's see. Only person that can reach is still through it.
Now maybe if it was a pig.
Or any of the other wild animals we've encountered so far.
No, I'm saying if you threw a pig.
22, I assume hits.
Yeah.
It's a Muppets reference, think of that.
Gotcha.
3 damage.
3?
Mm-hmm.
Alright.
Now it is your turn.
Okay. 5 foot step back. And I have reach into that square?
Yes.
Alright. And attack. Does a 14 hit?
It does.
Alright. Six.
Alright. Super.
So, no more Touch of Destiny for you.
Oh, I didn't even factor that in.
Well, it would have just made your attack go 1 point higher.
Okay.
I don't want to get in the way of you.
I can still attack through a friendly space with a spear, can I?
You can.
Okay.
Okay.
There's a cover penalty for it, but you can.
Okay.
Then why are you going first?
Because I'm pretty.
Ha! What do I... Oh, yeah. 5 foot step up, not raging. I'm going to save what I have left of that for later. Attack. Wow. Not raging, and I get a high roll. That's a 21.
Actually, so that if they move through, you get an attack of opportunity. So you
okay.
Eleven points of damage.
And it goes down.
Nice. Just one of those stepping forward and using the momentum to bring the great sword up and over onto it.
Alright. So what do you do? Frog is dead.
Frog legs. There's a fire in the other room. There's a frog right here.
I am okay with this. That sounds delicious.
So, what all is inside the room if we step in?
Or inside the frog's gut.
Cracks in the walls and ceilings of this chamber have allowed rainwater to collect here, flooding the room and giving rise to a profusion of mold and fungus along the walls and ceilings. The water is only ankle deep. The mold and fungus on the walls look harmless.
I put a bandana over my nose and mouth before going in.
Alright.
Hey, Tella, there's another door here if you want to check it out.
Oh, why not?
Door and see that it's just broken part of the fortress.
So we we still got another floor to climb up?
One more.
Alright. So to go back to the central stairwell, actually say it in on point.
Say like, right.
The elf guy on point. Atala behind him. Keone in the middle. Cleric on rear guard. I'm not sure how we'd arrange that, but we do.
Okay. Well, it'll have to be rearranged, but get up top. Anyway.
There is a lizard. If I were a thief, I would sneak up and backstab that troglodyte.
The troglodyte hears you coming up, turns around.
Aww.
Let me do a description here. The four wings of the tower are completely open on this level, forming one great cross-shaped chamber with an arched ceiling. The decayed remnants of a carpet run from the doorway at the end of each wing, meeting in the center where the spiral staircase drops out of sight below. A large throne-like chair stands in the middle of the eastern wing next to a big chest. So the troglodyte turns around and screeches. And his albino alligator walks up, runs over, and snaps at Siegfried.
Uh-oh.
Waking up late.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That'll do it.
Okay.
Did you have lunch?
Kind of. My lunch. Kind of. My lunch was everyone else's supper.
Did you have dinner then?
You were all leave.
All right.
Gotcha.
Tuskog is first. Is again going to attack.
Did you just say crocodile?
Crocodile.
Because that would be so awesome, I'm just saying.
Crocodile?
The crocodile.
The crocodile.
That'd be cute.
22 hits.
Yep.
You take 3 damage from his bite. And the troglodyte casts a spell. Suddenly,
I'm not half the man I used to
call.
Oh, god damn it.
Right here.
God damn it.
Not a swarm. Anything but a swarm.
Let's Yeah. Or he's going to cast it.
Oh, but...
out of range. So it's going to land right here and do nothing this turn.
But Pathfinder Society doesn't allow for drawbacks like Fierce Fighters.
And... next up is... she's going to... hold her turn. Hold her action. So Siegfried's up.
Awesome. Definitely going to rage. Take my 5-foot step up. And use my actual standard action to attack the croc. Come on! That's 19.
It is.
Awesome. That's 12 points of damage.
Alright. Still going to wait, so it's Hala's turn.
Alrighty. Crocodiles in reach?
Yes.
Alright. Hits?
15 does not hit.
Oh, dick. Alright.
Alright, at this point, Kara's still gonna wait. So, Keone.
I sing a song.
You sing a song.
Play the rest of it.
Everybody gets a plus one. As a rough, get you later, I roll. I'll be gone, I'll be on. I'm no longer your fool. The crap fills the gap while I wait to begin the adventure of my life in the land of Skyrim.
And he's dead from playing too long.
Yeah.
There we go.
Dude, Skyrim's not a game, it's a life.
That's very true.
It's very dim in the room, you can't see anything, so Kara's gonna hold up a compass similar to what the other guy had and cast a light spell. And so the room is now well lit, you can see everything clearly.
I can see clearly now. Rain.
Oh shit, spiders!
That's exactly how it goes.
Which means that there's about 3,000 of them.
Oh, shit!
No, 1,500.
How long
if they were flying, there were 3,000.
How long does a summon whatever spell last?
Depends on how fast John uses those acid flasks that he picked up.
Exactly. Lucky me, I'm after the trouble night.
Okay, so the
use the acid. Use the acid on the spiders.
9, I assume, does not hit Siegfried.
No. Even with his AC.
And Swarm is going to move up. And Tala gets hit. 4 points of damage. Need a fortitude save.
Cleric healed us up after the toad fight, right?
Yes.
Alrighty. That's good. That is very good. Alright, add a fortitude save. This is inconvenient.
All over you.
You're covered in spiders!
Arachnid.
Crawling along your skin!
And once again, he will cast a spell, and a giant centipede right here.
God damn it, you people.
Oh boy.
Is going to attack Keone.
If I toss the flask, is there any risk of hitting her?
Yes.
Honestly, well, I think getting the spiders is
no.
No.
Alright. Then...
You toss it here.
Alright, that's... Then, forego attacking the crocodile, I'm going to take the flask out and toss it.
Okay, and that does provoke an attack of opportunity.
Go ahead.
Twelve does not hit, I assume.
Nope.
And six does not either.
Nope.
Okay. So flask is thrown. Roll your damage.
Roll my damage? What would be the damage?
D6.
Six.
Alright.
Deals half again because it's a swarm.
Yep. And that is enough to kill the swarm.
So I dropped acid with Coleman and I killed the spiders.
Yeah.
Alrighty.
Instead of making you hallucinate spiders, they just all float away, man. The spiders, they're leaving my body.
Here's screeching of little tiny creatures as they burn.
I heard a thousand voices cry out and was suddenly silenced.
1,500 voices.
I heard 1,500 voices cry out and was suddenly silenced.
No regret, even though chickens in the room.
They're spiders.
They're creepy as shit.
And they were small spiders, which probably means that they were very poisonous, which...
They weren't. In fact.
But they're...
Yeah.
But they're fucking creepy.
Yeah. I'm okay with killing spiders.
And wasps.
Not the wasps!
Oh, the wasps.
Not the wasps! And
when they make a little nest... I get it. I get what you're
saying. We have wasps in our roof, and we have had them since we moved in, and I love watching them come in and out, and I love watching the birds eat them.
I'm going to attack the crocodile.
The crocodile?
Right. The crocodile.
It is forever the crocodile.
It is the crocodile.
I'm getting a +1 on my roll. Because... Alright. That won't hit either. I mean, not really.
Okay.
Much else I can do.
Will you have a move action left?
I can 5.
Or while you have a...
I can 5 foot
step.
Yeah, that's it. Alright. I guess 5 foot step. That away.
Alright. Keone?
Would a countersong affect the troglodytes? Okay, I'm gonna need clarification on what a countersong can actually do, but later...
It probably goes against another bard's song.
Ongoing effects is what it would be used against. So, like, a darkness spell.
Oh.
Like when Leary would use her... protection ability to give everyone like a +1 bonus to their armor class.
Mm-hmm.
You could probably use countersong to disable that.
Oh. Oh, okay.
So.
Alright, then I continue. Yeah, distraction wouldn't work either. I continue to sing awesome. Yeah, like that.
Yeah.
Be right back.
Oh, feet. Oh, ow. Ow. Stop hurting. Ow.
So she is singing. That brings us up to Kira, who's going to heal Siegfried.
Sweet.
For 8 points.
And so I'm back up to 4.
The troglodyte is screeching at you now. So it casts another spell, and yet another centipede drops in front of Atala.
Great.
And attacks. Does 13 hit?
Nope.
Alright.
Alright. I'm taking this damn thing out.
Gator attacks. 25 will hit.
Yep.
7 damage.
That kind of hurt.
And the centipede is going to attack. She just left. Keone. Yeah, that's going to hit her.
What was it?
21.
Yeah. Okay. Yes, I'm evading her items. It's for the sake of clarification.
AC of 16. How much did it hurt for?
3 points.
3 points.
But she needs a fortitude save.
Spreading around more minions. Time to take control of this battlefield. And I'm going to hate myself for doing this, but go ahead and take your 3 rolls of attack of opportunity because Siegfried's going straight for the troglodyte.
Okay.
You do realize that gives him 3 chances to seriously fuck your day up, right?
Does a 16 hit?
16 will hit.
Okay, you take 6 points of damage, and I need a fortitude save.
You got hit. You're now down to 5 hit points. You did make your fortitude save, though.
Fortitude good. Is 17.
It makes it. The other one is a 17.
Oh, damn.
You take 4 points of damage, and I need another fortitude save.
16 on the fortitude save, and now I'm unconscious and bleeding out. Well, I'm down to 0. I'm actually at exactly 0 hit points.
You are staggered.
Staggered. So, my move stops right as I reach him, and I can't make an attack, can I?
Your move stops here.
I got hit by the centipede, didn't I?
Yes. And he passes out.
I'm now passed out. Oh! And my rage drops, so I'm actually at -2 hit points.
Cool.
Okay.
I was trying to take control of this battlefield. I didn't count on getting hit twice. I figured I would get hit once.
Yeah.
Somebody has to take out that troglodyte before he fills the place up with bugs and whatnot. Should I roll since I'm now below 0?
You will roll next turn.
Okay.
It is now Atala's turn.
Okay.
Has anyone actually hit the crocodile?
Or the crocodile.
Yes.
So it is damaged. Mm-hmm. Okay.
It looks like it's in pretty bad shape.
Alright, she is going to attack.
I already figured that out for this scenario. I'm going to use the Unchained Barbarian's Rage rules.
Okay.
From now on.
15 plus. So, 19?
It hits.
Alright. And she is going to 5 foot step there.
Okay. Next up is Keone.
Nobody took the scrolls of Cure Light Wounds, did they? But we got a heal bot.
I'm not close enough to really do anything except sing.
Got that one.
Yes, but.
She's carrying a non-lethal weapon.
It does a D4. I'm not a damage dealer. I do have a short bow.
You could take a 5 foot step back and fire.
And she'd have to drop and draw. I assume you don't have quick draw.
No, I don't.
So that would be the action.
Cure things either. Jeez.
Just
yeah, I'm playing. Not. Yeah, I'm gonna keep playing.
Okay.
Don't go towards the light.
Cure is going to attack. She'll hit it, and she kills the one.
Want some coffee? You're gonna get some.
Next up is troglodytes. He is now frothing at the mouth. Drops the sword he's holding and casts a spell. And a sword of fire is in his hand.
Uh-oh.
That's
not
bad.
Not as big a deal as it sounds.
Okay.
It's okay.
Okay.
I mean...
So he steps up and is going to attack Kara. And
wait, what happened to the centipede?
It tried to attack the cleric and failed miserably.
Oh, okay.
So, Siegfried...
As he's stuffing his guts back into his body.
I'm rolling my constitution modifier, right?
Yes. Let's see. What is it? I'm used to...
Ah, shit. I got a 7.
Dying hit points. So you lose 1 hit point.
That was me. I got a 7. So that's another hit point loss?
Yes.
Well, my constitution score is a 14.
I have the feeling you'll be fine.
Yeah. So.
So next time you'll be
fine. As long as the troglodyte doesn't touch me.
Yeah. Next up is Atala.
and someone can perform a heal roll to stabilize me as well.
I don't have that. I mean, I can try.
If I have 5 foot step, I can still attack a centipede.
You can.
Alrighty. That does not hit.
Heal can be performed untrained.
It was a 6 on the die. So
and you would just roll a flat d20. So.
You really trust just a flat d20 when we have a cleric?
Yeah.
True.
Now it is Keone's turn.
I can make pretty lights. That's not really going to help anyone. So I'm gonna keep singing.
Cleric's turn. Steps up. 5 foot steps. And heals you for 3 points.
Woo!
3 hit points.
So that puts you at 0, right?
Yeah, it puts me at 0.
Okay, so you are staggered. You're conscious again, but you are currently prone.
Yep.
Next up is the troglodyte. It's going to run up and take a swing at the cleric, because it knows what's up. Let's see.
What's up?
It will hit her. Centipede is going to step here and attack Atala. It misses. Siegfried.
So the troglodyte's going after the cleric. I can only do one thing. What's the cleric's attack power like?
It's not bad.
I'm going to continue playing the team member here, and looking up, seeing the situation, just going to reach out to the cleric's foot and touch of destiny her.
You can't.
Aww. Seriously?
Since you're staggered, you can't. If you attempt to do anything other than stand up or something like heal yourself, it would make you go unconscious again.
It's just too much, bro.
It's just too much.
Just stay there.
Don't move.
Yeah. I'll just hold out.
All you can really do in your case is stand up, and that provokes an attack of opportunity, so
I'm just going to hold action then.
Yeah. Okay. So,
you're not dead. That's the important part.
Next up is Atala.
I could just sacrifice my consciousness by still doing Touch of Destiny, but I'll stay conscious.
It wouldn't work. You would fall unconscious before it took effect.
5 foot step and attack. And another 6. Yes.
Alright. Keone.
Oh, that guy's like right there, isn't he?
Yep.
I can't trip it.
Kinda hard to trip a centipede.
Yep.
Yeah, I take a 5 foot step back and keep playing.
Somebody's gotta do something.
Yeah.
Help, we need somebody.
We're screwed.
Yeah.
This fight's actually going fairly well. It's going
pretty
far in our favor.
So
Arthur was forced to eat Robin's minstrels, and there was much rejoicing. Yay!
Kira is going to you're still prone.
Yeah.
You can stand up now if you would like.
I will.
All right. Attack of opportunity does 14 hit.
No.
All right.
Awesome. Can I take a swing at him?
No. On your turn.
Well, it was my turn. That's why I stood up.
On your next turn.
Yes. So that brings it to Troglodyte. It's going to step up and try again.
You mean Centipede?
Centipede is going to step up and try again. Does an 18 hit?
Yes.
All right.
You go boom boom.
You take 1 point of 1 point of damage, and I need a fortitude save.
That doesn't make it.
Okay.
Nothing happens yet.
Yet.
Tala, it's your turn.
5 foot step on attack. What the hell is it with me and sixes?
Okay, six. There's this troglodyte boss standing over here that's about to start getting beat on. But the epic battle is between the spear wielder and the summoned centipede.
Yeah. I can just see it now, and he's jabbing and poking, and it's just like, ah.
I had one of those one time where it was me versus a skeleton while everybody else, like, I was finishing off the last mook skeleton while everybody else was dealing with the boss, and it and I just kept missing. It was like 8 rounds before I actually hit it, and it had like 3 hit points.
Wow.
But over here, we got the equivalent of
anyways,
boss
aren't
getting
summoned creatures supposed to have, like, a time limit of, like, 3 rounds?
Uh-huh. So that was, yeah.
You guys...
it's going to disappear next.
Okay.
You and this centipede are having the equivalent of Skywalker versus Vader at the end of him, at the end of Return of the Jedi.
Now we
going
have
on.
Keone.
The chorus is going and everything.
I'm helping. I'm totally useful.
How far in have you read Order of the Stick?
Not far enough,
okay.
I guess.
Because that's basically what the bard in it does. For the first little while.
Yeah.
Because well, that's all bards can basically do. I'm kind of hoping. A little bit.
Yeah.
Well,
maybe a little bit.
Well,
playing. I'll just keep playing.
Yeah.
Okay.
I'm reminded of...
Sneak quietly. Why?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm reminded of gamers, too. Bard, you usually play a fighter. Same thing, right?
What's the difference?
Pure attacks. Here
gets a 20. Don't worry, guys. I'll help. And the goblins attack.
Oh, I came prepared. New character.
Okay. I know, we make a barricade out of the bodies of dead guards.
How many of those did you bring?
Enough.
Enough.
Right. It is Siegfried's turn.
I'm going to go ahead. Wait, how does the Troglodyte look?
He just got roughed up pretty good by the cleric.
I am going to
by the cleric.
By the cleric.
I'm going to do my last round of raging. Well, it's just going to go back to 9 because my rage drops after this. My last round of rage. And I'm going to swing at that damn thing.
Do it.
Give me this.
Kill it.
Give me this.
Kill it dead.
That's 17.
It hits.
Thank the god.
No. Thank the bandage tin.
Thank Kawaii.
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 I'm now fatigued until my next turn.
Excuse me.
It's going to...
Excuse me.
Step back. Screaming.
Yelling racial obscenities?
Yes. Okay. Which I assume none of you can understand.
No.
Is it in Gnome or Celestial?
No.
Okay.
Or Sylvan?
No. And creates a small flame, which he throws at Siegfried. Does a 17 would hit, right?
Which AC? Well, doesn't matter, see, because, yeah.
Okay. Does 4 points of fire damage.
So I'm down to 5.
Okay. So, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Puts them in range.
Yep.
Even worse. You have to consider, I got like, what, 2 critical hits on the in the last game?
Yeah.
So I'm kind of paying for it now.
Yeah, you are.
Keone!
Hit better, hit better. Let's struggle tonight. We can do this, guys.
Cleric's going to heal Siegfried again.
Yeah. So I can move up.
You take 9, or get 9 hit points back again.
Almost full. That's good.
And next is Siegfried.
Who is currently fatigued, but that doesn't affect my attack, I believe. Oh yeah, it does. It drops my strength score. It drops my strength score.
You'll have
it. By 1 point.
Minus 1, yep.
So, step up. And rolling with a +2 to the roll. 14?
Does not hit.
Well, at least I'm no longer fatigued.
Yep. He will turn and... let's see. Attack. 21 tie chasing, that hits.
Yeah.
That will miss. And that will miss. You take 6 points of fire damage.
Was he casting a spell on me?
That was his flaming blade.
Oh, okay.
And now it is...
My turn.
Turn, yeah.
Does a full attack grant any bonus? Okay.
So you only have the 1 attack anyway.
Yeah.
Oh, fine a fucking Lee. Let's see, 14 plus 4, 18.
It hits.
Alright. Does the song also boost damage or just attack rolls?
Damage.
8.
And he goes down. First level fights suck.
Yeah, because your options are so limited.
Mm-hmm. Medic!
Alright, she heals everybody up.
Even curing whatever the thing got me with?
It didn't get you.
The poison?
You made your save, didn't you?
The second time I did it.
Oh, that's right. No, you didn't. So, you take...
Why did you have to remind him?
I'm being fair.
Okay.
One point of dexterity damage.
Ouch.
But that goes away with all the healings we get, right?
Not with the healing, but it will with rest.
Okay.
All my rage powers are spent, so hopefully there's no more fighting in the next...
There's not.
For earth is shocking.
You're good. So everybody's healed up. There's this large wooden chest, as well as, and he has a key on him.
I'm going to take the key and open the chest.
Right. Masterwork short sword, 15 cold iron, shurikens, 2 flasks of acid, 2 potions. Oh, he had a wand of summon monster on him.
Ah, that explains all this.
Yeah. It had 9 charges, so if I was a real dick, I could have just became tall. Boop, boop,
boop. Yeah, that's why I was trying to go after him.
I limited myself to 2.
Thank you.
Yeah.
That second one was a doozy.
Yeah.
Yeah?
That was the most epic fight I've ever had.
With a bug, too.
And the level 1 fighter's going, I'm badass! I'm badass!
I did come in for the kill steal.
I went 3 rounds with a creature that only has 5 hit points!
That takes talent.
Oh, yeah.
Alright.
They will the bard will sing songs of your epic fight.
Yes.
So.
I'm just going to go ahead and take all of it since we turned it in anyway.
Yeah. So, with his defeat and that of the troglodytes, the fortress is now once again abandoned. So, you head out, and that's all we're going to use roll 20 for the night. You head out and go and meet up Balinor at the lodge that he suggests you do stop in at.
Cool. Awesome.
Actually, we never got his name the first time around.
Yeah. Okay, well, he would have introduced himself as Balinor.
Okay.
And she takes a quick break. Be right back.
Okay. Quick, while he's away, look at his notes!
Going to go with the unleashed barbarian rage rules. It only gives the pluses to my attack and damage only compared to everything else, but having those extra 2 hit points as temporary would be nice. Because that's the only reason I dropped below 0 was losing those 2 hit points from my rage dropping.
I'll have to look at the spells again. I know there were quite a few that were pretty useful, but I don't think I picked the right ones.
Well, I'm shaping to answer your one question on the Pathfinder page. The faction thing is purely a roleplay basis.
Oh.
But the people of the Dark Archive, they're main purpose is to collect quote-unquote evil artifacts and relics and find a way to use said evil and cursed items for good purposes, even though they use evil magic and or are cursed.
Okay.
Because, you know, that always works well.
Yeah.
Every time someone's trying to use something like that.
Most of the time they just end up being cataloged and studied. So, can't think of one off the top of my head, but I know there's a perfect video game or movie example out there.
The Ark of the Covenant?
Pretty much.
Okay.
Alright. Cool.
It's being handled by top men.
You are men.
Then the Grand Lodge is just the base faction that everybody joins by default.
Yes.
All the other factions are on that society guide that everyone downloaded.
Did you see what I posted in the Facebook group?
I essentially haven't been on the computer for like a week now. Because I've been doing a lot.
I would die.
You know, every time I get on Facebook like multiple times a day, but every time I'm on, I'm like, why the hell am I doing this?
Yeah. Well, yeah. It's not so much Facebook. I do
everything on the computer. I've been doing other things on my iPad, but it's hard to do, like, Facebook stuff on my iPad, because sometimes it doesn't work, and it's...
So we meet, what's his name at the lodge? Right.
Anyway.
Balinor.
Balinor.
So you... he is waiting on the out front as you come up. He says, come in, come in! So you follow him in, have a seat at his table. He says, order whatever you like tonight. It's all on me.
She orders the most expensive stuff. As much as she can stomach.
He just smiles.
Well, what type of place is it?
It's pretty good. Like, it's a pretty decent place.
Okay, I was wondering, yeah. Like, seafood? Are we talking, like, fried chicken?
Lobster?
It's not filet mignon. But it's pretty...
So it's, like, good salmon.
It's, yeah. It's
but not necessarily stuff. Lobster.
Right.
She gets the nice stew. You know, the one that isn't a bowl of dirt. So,
for the record, we've now ended the scenario, so it's over.
Cool.
Yeah, sometimes the light bulbs like to flicker. And...
I was like, is there a bug right here or what?
No. Okay. They just want to screw with you.
Balinor actually stays with the group in the scenario, but this gave him leaving gave the plug for moving it along campaign style, and he's also a bard. So, he's a level 3 bard, so he would have kind of upstaged you. So, we left him out.
Okay, then.
Good.
Oh, yeah.
We don't want anyone upstaging me.
No.
No.
So you, have spent the evening just sitting around talking, sharing stories. You're all full. Table is covered in plates and glasses. He calls for one more round of ale. And leans forward and says, first, I would like to thank you again for saving my life today. I rushed in to something that I really knew better. I've had better training than to do something as reckless as that.
Well, thankfully we hadn't.
Exactly.
Oh, yeah.
He grins. I'm a member of an organization called the Pathfinder Society. I'm sure you've heard of us. Believe only half of what you've heard. But we are always looking for people with potential who could have a great impact on the future of Absalom, on the future of Glorian. After your actions today, I believe y'all would do very well if you would be interested.
What does this society pertain to if we're not to believe half of what we've heard?
We're not all thugs, we're not all thieves, we're not all murderers. We do have a handful, naturally. But most of those stick to the Aspis Consortium, but I digress. We'll learn about them later on. Our goals are to collect information and items that, in a lot of ways, in the wrong hands, could cause a great deal of harm. So we, in that sense, we're protectors.
Do you ever use these things to...
Much of what we find, we do not. We're given orders to go find the information or find these items. Frequently they're too dangerous or not understood well enough to be used. We have, under the lodge, there is a great store of well-guarded
group of people who are cataloging them, which will make studying them much easier so that we can determine what would be useful, what wouldn't. But in general, no, we don't use most of what we find.
Do you answer to anybody?
We do. We answer directly to our venture captains, specifically venture captain Ambrose Falsane, who, if you wish to join the society, you will meet. And the venture captains answer to the Decemvirates. They're a group of 10 people, no one knows their identity, for their safety, who are the ones who give out the jobs that we go after, who they're in charge of finding these items, knowing this information, and then the venture captains are tasked with the day-to-day jobs, their day-to-day chore of assigning the jobs and making sure things are carried out properly.
Not to sound too mercenary, but is this a volunteer position, or are we compensated for our efforts?
You are compensated, yes. As well, any of your needs are normally taken care of. Food, whatever resources you need, they're provided for you. You are not... It is voluntary in the sense that you can... You are still free to pursue your own goals, whatever they may be. And so you're not required to be tied strictly to the society.
Yeah, I'm sure the society has its own governing rules as far as going outside of their laws.
To an extent, yes. If you're doing something that could... Well, you are a Pathfinder, if you remember, whether you're doing something that is for the society at the time or not. So, as such, naturally, the Decemvirate would not want you doing anything that could bring shame to the name of Pathfinder Society.
And what would be an example of an act that would bring shame to the Pathfinder Society?
Senselessly murdering people, using magic in ways that you may not understand or that would call someone to innocence. Such things as this.
Well, I'm not doing anything else right now, so...
I don't have any plans to do anything like that in the near future, so...
What's required to join?
Well, for most, the majority of people come to us fresh. I did, as well. You have 3 years of training under three masters. One is the master of the swords, he teaches us how to fight. One is the master of scrolls, he teaches us about magic. And the other is the master of spells, he teaches us about magic. The other is the master of scrolls, and he teaches us how to understand the lore of what we're looking at. He teaches more of the book knowledge, I'll say. So we spend 3 years under their tutelage, some people shorter if they're exceptional. And after that, we have, it's called a confirmation, where we're tasked with something that is, it's basically our first official mission in the society. And depending on how that goes, we are either accepted into the society or not. However, we do make exceptions for exceptional people, such as yourselves, who would be...
like our friend here who went toe-to-toe with a giant centipede.
Hey, that was an epic fight.
It was. I was watching. I wrote a song about it. You want to hear?
Sure.
There's a stage right over there.
Giant centipede with spear.
So you said that you're a high-level bar.
What are these levels you speak of? I'm in.
It's underneath the chair, I think.
Okay. You will still be required to spend a short period of time with each of the masters to determine your... just as a formality, to determine if you are properly qualified. I, for all three of you, will gladly be your sponsor. You did meet Kira. I saw as you were out. I don't know if she revealed it to you or not, but she is also a member of Pathfinder Society.
She had the same looking compass as you.
Yes. This is a wayfinder. It's something that every Pathfinder has. It has specific ability. All of them are able to cast, are able to brighten areas of darkness for us as we need, as well as functioning as a typical compass. Some of them also have greater power, but those are much more rare. The Wayfinders aren't an invention of the Pathfinder Society. They're something that was discovered early on in the society's history, and we just use it. It's one of the handful of things that we do use to our benefit.
I see.
So, since you all are interested, please enjoy your evening. I'll come and get you tomorrow morning, and we will go, and I will introduce you to our adventure captain.
Cool.
Good.
Alright. Good evening, man. And he leaves.
So what do you guys think about this?
I don't know. I've heard the usual stories of the society, so at least get to see how they are on the inside. And it would be something to do under wandering aimlessly from town to town, doing odd jobs.
I like that they'll cover room and board and food.
I mean, I'd like to say that I'm able to go out and save towns, solely out of the charity of my art, but at some point you need to get paid for what you're doing, and there you are, a steady paycheck.
Alright, so, next morning rolls around, he comes and gets you, and he takes you to meet this guy.
That is an awesome looking haircut and mustache.
Yeah.
I love this guy.
The mutton chop mustache.
At this point, is this when we're able to change characters and change everything about ourselves?
Yes.
Okay. Hey, Atala wakes up the next morning and she's a completely different person.
I'll post to the group the items on the sheet, since my printer's still down. I can't print off the sheets yet, but no one really knew. So.
Gotcha.
We'll get to that. Balinar takes you to his office. And Ambrose is sitting behind a large mahogany desk. Says, "Come in, please.
Mahogany.
Have a seat."
Is there like bookshelves or anything?
Yes.
What is on the bookshelves? Like, what kind of books?
Kama Sutra from Nome.
That's just regular Nome literature.
Yeah.
On his shelves, you see. Books. He doesn't have a large selection of books. He has some. Most of them are on. he has two shelves. One of them is on combat styles, various forms of magic that people have studied, so on and so forth, lore of different areas. On the other shelf are books that you've never seen before. That on the ends just say Chronicles, and it looks like a large set of encyclopedias.
Huh.
So, what Chronicles is, you don't know yet.
I go over and pull out the first Chronicles and start reading.
Alright.
Is this what you do as soon as someone invites you into their office?
Yeah, it's what you have bookshelves for. To read
He's
books.
Not perturbed by this at all.
She's a bard. She wants to learn.
What you hold there is one of our chronicles of the society. The greatest deeds, or most noteworthy deeds, of our Pathfinders are recorded and put in those books.
Cool.
You'll find that many of them are rather old-fashioned. Many of them contain misinformation. But as the society has grown stronger, we have collectively gotten better at getting things right. So,
nice.
Down to business. I have spoken with Balinar of your exploits and what you faced. I believe you would be excellent candidates for the Pathfinder Society. I'm sure he told me that he did mention the masters that you'll need to meet today. This won't take too long, by the way, about 15 minutes.
Alrighty.
And after them, depending on their recommendations, we will allow you to... the confirmation is still required, so assuming things go well, I do have a task that I will send you on as your confirmation.
Cool.
So, I'll send you on your way. Have an assistant here who will take you first to the Master of Swords.
Cool. Can I borrow this?
You can't have that copy, but you'll be able to find one easily enough.
She puts it back.
Reluctantly.
Reluctantly.
Yeah.
Like, aww.
Let's see. There's the search. So, the servant takes you out to... the courtyard, where you see a large man overseeing people who clearly have had very little experience with weapons, as other people are training them. However, he doesn't seem to be upset by this. He seems to be in a very good mood. This is him. This is Marcos Farabalus. He is the Master of Swords. As you walk up, he sees you and says, "Ha! There you are! I've been waiting for you! I was told you would be coming! Come! Come! What's your weapon of choice, fighter?"
She, because this is a completely different character, she kind of half unsheathes Estoc rapiers.
Alright. He walks over to... What about you?
He points to his back and says, "Great sword."
I like you.
Hmm.
And you?
She wields her guitar.
I unsheathe my deadly...
You're fine.
...mandolin.
So he walks over to a counter. And you'll still have dice out?
Yeah.
Okay, yes.
Cool. And he... a row of wooden swords, grabs two swords, tosses them to you, grabs a wooden,
wooden great sword.
Yeah, great sword, tosses to you, and grabs a sword himself and says, "All right, come on." So,
fighting with wood swords.
Siegfried gives a shrug and does a full-on charge at him.
All right.
Yes, because the smartest idea is to always run forward.
And a charge is plus
1
or plus
2.
Plus
2.
Yeah.
It's minus 2 to AC, plus 2 to attack.
It's 19.
That hits him. He laughs. It's all of them are D4s.
Okay. Two, since it's a great song.
Yeah.
Five.
The last. Good hit, good hit! And takes a swing. And misses.
Awesome.
Alright. She's just going to attack with one sword. That means that it doesn't take the two weapon
correct
penalty. It just... Alrighty. 24. And that's in the critical range.
I have to re-roll it.
Okay. Yeah.
Rolling critical successes, so, but it doesn't matter.
Criticals aren't gonna matter. It's
I know, but it's for but, flavor.
Yeah.
So that's 2d4 plus 2. Or that's 2d4 plus 1 each, so 4d4 plus 2.
Just 1d4.
1d4?
1d4.
Because it's wooden and
yes,
not...
Non-lethal.
Okay.
Yeah.
I'm not going to dig through that to get a d4. 3.
Alright. He steps back. Cheer turn again.
Steps back.
Goes into a more defensive posture.
As just to show off more, he's going to step forward in rage and go again.
Two against one.
Yes! Yes!
That's also my crit range, so yeah.
Alright.
Just a regular hit. That's 13 non-lethal damage.
Good! Good! Looks at the fighter, says, your turn. 19 hit?
Yes.
Okay, he does 6 points of non-lethal damage.
Okay. My turn again?
Yep.
Still a single hit. Does a 19 hit him?
Yes.
Okay. Four.
Alright. He's laughing because it's okay, stop! Stop, good form. I see you know your way around a weapon. Yes, I will recommend you.
Good.
He calls over servant who tends to your wounds, heals you all up. Let's see.
That'd be a shame if we killed him right there in the train.
Well,
you can't really kill
him. I know, I'm just saying.
I'm kind of reminded of the beginning hours of the first Kingdom Hearts game when you're just on the island and everyone has the wooden weapons.
He's a 6-fighter, 3 rogue, so.
Okay.
If he wanted to, he could have annihilated
yeah
you.
Selfie had her whip and Waka had a ball, but still.
Well, unfortunately, the next person I'll send you on to is Aaron Zay. He's our master of scrolls.
let's just say we were one of those people who never really paid attention in school. Are we going to be okay?
Oh, well. We'll see. So, he sent you on your way. He's still laughing. And he sent you to see this guy.
He doesn't look very happy.
No. The servant takes you in. about 15 feet from the door, he just points. Won't even go near it.
That bad, huh?
So you open the door, and you see him just sitting behind a desk. Well, come in and sit down already.
Oh, this is going to be fun.
She sits down.
He sits and just crosses his arms, being the douchebag elf.
He just looks at you very condescendingly. He says, "You, what do you know of magic?"
What would you like to know?
That's all I need to know. What are you? Why should I let you in the Pathfinder Society? What do you know of magic?
Because I'm willing to learn. That's why you should let me in.
Fine.
Prestidigitation!
I'm beyond being impressed by tricks. You! Attack me.
Attack you. Alright. Could we just say I also get the time to do do my own touch of destiny?
You're gonna touch yourself in a special place.
Put your sword down and attack me with magic.
I am not trained enough to use magic as of yet. I am only able to gauge my own power or the power of anybody else through touch.
Fine. He walks up to you. He says, "What do you see?"
What do I see?
He wants you to gauge him.
Oh. As in, he just reaches out and performs Touch of Destiny on him.
Okay.
So he feels himself strengthened.
That's it, huh?
That's
what you got?
I'm apparently what's called a blood rage.
Fine. Do you know how to use scrolls? Wands?
Do I?
I do have a two of magic device, so yeah.
You can use them if they're on your... Yeah.
Okay.
Yes. Not everybody here is capable of a name.
I didn't ask you to speak.
Discern next of kin?
He turns and just looks at you.
It's nothing? I don't get anything
from
you?
Fine.
I say go for it.
I'm sending you to Crichton. Oh, servant will take you to him.
That's a good thing, right?
Alright, let's go.
Thank you.
We're not here to impress him. Let's just go.
He sits down in his chair and starts writing and ignores you again.
Actually, I think the point was to impress him.
If I was the equivalent of being 4 levels higher in roleplay speech, I would have the ability to cast spells, but I only have my blood power right now.
I don't know what
he was looking for.
I could distract him, but... He said he doesn't like tricks.
He approved of us, so let's go on to the next guy.
Yeah, he did.
No, he said, fine. Go on, leave.
He didn't say that he approved.
Oh. Well, he's sending us to the next guy anyway, so let's go.
Yep.
Okay.
Who's also the one of magic, even though he was the one of scrolls.
So you're being... Well, he was master of spells. You're now going to master of scrolls.
Okay.
He is in charge of lore and also, problem solving and such. So, you go to another room. And you go in and you sit down. And sitting in front of you is this guy. He's holding a box in front of him. It's an octagonal box, and it's got different runes and such on it.
Oh, no.
And every once in a while, they just reach over and touches one of them.
Oh.
And turns it. You don't even think he knows you're in the room yet. Just touch another one.
Knowledge, history.
Is that a new form of Rubik's Cube?
He startles. Oh, hello! You must be Crichton's friends, or whatever his name is. Balinor's friends.
Yes.
Well, hello.
Yeah.
I'm Crichton Shane. I'm the master of squirrels here.
Hi.
I hope you're a lot nicer than the last guy. I kind of wanted to put his head through the table.
I see you've met Aram already.
Yes.
Well, my job is rather simple. You, I see that, I told you already picked up one of our chronicles and began looking through it.
Yeah.
Any of those things I see, they come through me and decide what goes in, or help the Dissenter decide what goes in. I'm also in charge of things like this.
What is it?
I don't know yet.
Cool.
But I hope to. Soon. I think I will.
You're a very old elf, aren't you?
I suppose so. Mm-hmm. Goes back to looking at it for a minute.
That would explain why he helped with all of those chronicles.
So you want to be Pathfinders?
Yeah.
We have three tenets in the Pathfinder Society. Explore, report, and cooperate. Each of them is very important in its own right, but together they make up what is the Pathfinder Society. If you explore, but you aren't cooperating, and you aren't reporting back, then you're doing nothing for us. If all you're doing is reporting, but you're not going anywhere, or cooperating, you're not helping us. Obviously, if you're not cooperating with other Pathfinders, you should be on your own. So you want to be Pathfinders?
Yeah.
Okay.
We just went through a tower together. I'm pretty sure we got the cooperating part down pat.
I'm pretty useless without friends. So.
Okay. I'll tell Ambrose I approve of. Thank you. It was a pleasure meeting you. He goes back to looking at his thing.
You
pushes
too.
A room.
Can I do a quick knowledge arcane on it?
Sure.
Knowledge history wouldn't do anything.
Wow. That's 22.
It is definitely magical.
I at least know that. I'm leaving now. Bye.
Yeah.
Level 7 diviner, level 3 lore master.
Wow. Yeah.
So he's prestige classed.
Yes.
Okay then.
So you go back to Ambrose. Sit down. He says, Come in. I just received the letters. I haven't opened them yet. Let's have a look through them, why don't we?
Oh yeah, let's.
Says, okay, well. It appears Marcos approves. He says, you know which end to stick in the other guy. That's important.
He doesn't appear to... He appears to always wear his emotions on his sleeves, too.
Yes, he does. He's, sometimes we have to do very dark work, and he's always a bright spot in a Pathfinder's day. So let's see. Crichton, well, he's easy. He says you definitely appear to show interest, and I see he explained the tenets to you. Good. Yeah. All right. Well, let's see, Arms.
Yeah.
Oh, well. Looks like Arm approves of you with flying colors.
Excuse me?
Really?
Yes.
I say, what now?
Don't be put off by Arm. He's quite a character, as you may be able to tell.
Quite a character.
By the way, I think of Arm as kind of like Snape. Mm. If that helps.
Yes, it does.
Okay.
Now I just see Siegfried being belittled by Alan Rickman. And it's glorious. Yes.
Oh, very glorious.
Hello, Alan Rickman. This is Alan Rickman reminding you to tell that joke at the party. Never come across a human whose head I wanted to put through a table so badly.
Well, it's a good thing you didn't.
I guess so.
It's all right. Well, if you go back to the tavern where you met Balinor after your success, you will run the beginning of your task there. I look forward to seeing you again.
Cool.
Awesome.
Send you on your way, and that's where we're going to stop. Hooray!
Yay! Cool.
Oh, the society characters.
Oh, excuse me.
So,
you may end the recording now.
Alright. Good night, everyone.
Night!
Get the hell out of here.